many of us dream of becoming a speaker. Actually, there's always a story behind it. Since I am a speaker, you're going to have to hear this story. And the story goes all the way back to the beginning, where I'm from. I'm from Ohio. And actually, I'm from an area that was called the preppy capital of the world. Yeah, it was very preppy. Madras and penny loafers and all that stuff going on over here. We call them monograms.
Cigarette.
Yeah. And my mom was the credit manager of a very upscale department store. Very she. And when I was born, she went to work like right after I was born, the story goes. And she must have felt guilty. So any opportunity she had, she would bring me to the store. And I kind of became the store mascot. And so I had retail like in my blood. I moved to Houston. After college, I moved to Houston. I got a degree in education, but I really didn't use it because when I moved to Houston, I noticed that there were no preppies around. So it was like an opportunity for me to open a store. Retail was in my blood. So I opened my first store and it was very successful. And so in the end, I had four stores. So I opened them in the early 80s, late 70s, early 80s. And things were going really well. Everybody was preppy now in Houston. Grandma, mom, little girls, everybody was shopping with me. And then, this is true, the first kind of little earth-shattering thing that happened was Madonna. Madonna came out with a song. This is interesting.
She'd like to hear that.
Yeah, right. Madonna was the ruination of my business. But the first thing happened was she came out with a song called Like a Virgin, and MTV had come out around the same time. So now young girls could look at MTV and they could see Madonna, and she wasn't preppy. She was wearing a bustier with the beauty mark, and they looked at Madonna and they looked at Grandma, and they said, Mom, Grandma, I'm leaving. I'm going with Madonna. And the girls went rock and roll. But I didn't really notice because the 80s were like this crazy time in business. Like we thought that the joy would never be over. You know, that pot of gold at the end of the rainbow was there for all of us. But you know what? That didn't stop me because I just worked harder. I didn't even really notice that I was losing half of my business to MTV and Madonna. So then the next incident, I don't want to call it a catastrophe because I didn't really know it was a catastrophe until I really looked back on it, was casual dress. You know, someone said it was Bill Gates' fault. I'm not sure. It was somebody up there in Palo Alto. But, you know, programmers, Gen X programmers were coming on the scene and they were working 24/7. And this whole idea of let's make it comfortable for them became a trend. And this trend really took over the fashion business and everybody was dressing casual for work. It was killing me. Women stopped ironing, right? Most of my clothes were 100% cotton and they needed to be ironed. But women were not ironing. And so my shoppers started to dwindle, and I realized that really for me, the sort of business I had, preppy was over. And I knew that I had to get out. And so I closed a couple stores, I actually sold one, and in the end, there I sat, you know, with what was I gonna do with the rest of my life? So I took myself and I took all my information and I went to a career coach. It's interesting because they map out all the things you're good at, and we went all the way back to college where I got a degree in education and this whole thing about teaching, and the coach came up with, why not be a speaker? Why not be a business speaker? And I thought that sounded like a great idea. Yeah, no inventory and no rent. I like that, you know? So I went to a National Speakers Association meeting in Houston, and I approached it like graduate school. I mean, I would go to those meetings and I would take copious notes, and by 2000, I was speaking. I was getting paid to speak. And so that's the story. It's a little long, but that's me. That's what happened. In the beginning, I had a program called The Look of Leadership. And it was interesting because casual dress was still on the scene. And so I would go in and I would tell people how to dress professionally. And I would have to say no to everybody, like, no, you can't wear that, no, no, no. And I realized that I was a motivational speaker. I wasn't one of these negative speakers. So I had to really sit down and think about what it was that I wanted to have as my platform. You know, what did I want to speak on? And so in the beginning, it started, it was kind of funny because I started speaking in 2000. And I live in Houston, and my first clients back then, you're not going to believe this, but they were Enron, Arthur Anderson, and Bank of America. And they all like were into this whole look of leadership and branding and all of the things I was speaking on. And I thought that I was on easy street because I had these big names. And then in 2001, first 9/11 hit, which really was very, very devastating to most speakers. But for me, I still had my Houston business. And then by the end of 2001, we know what happened to Enron, Arthur Andersen. They went away. And so I had to start over. And it was interesting because this whole theme of reinvention kept cropping up again. First was the business, then I had to reinvent myself to become a speaker, and then I had to find a new topic and I had to start over. And that was when I decided that I would speak on change. Because I was realizing that if I didn't change, you know, things were not going to get better for me. And I had to begin to look at change as a positive and to really see the opportunities that change presented. And that's really where I kind of went into change and the generations and then eventually technology. So I feel like I've kind of moved along with my talks right into my area. The very first speech I ever gave was called The Seven Women. And I was teaching women how to dress, and I was showing them their seven fashion personalities. And so I did a public seminar. So I invited all my customers to it, and it was amazing because they all came, right? And so I had this idea back in really in 2000 on the seven women. And then my daughter Meredith graduated from school and got into the workforce, and she said, let's take that idea of the Seven Women Project and let's write a book about the seven personalities that women have and how they can use these strengths and their talents in the workplace. And so we really got together and we wrote this book, and it's been amazing because she's from a different generation than I am. So it really kind of, It really kind of reinforced my speaking on the generations, because having to work side by side with my daughter and she's in another generation, it really gave me a lot of insight into what people are dealing with at work. You know, not just coming from a speaker, but real firsthand. So we wrote the book, and I love speaking on the Seven Women Project because it's really about helping women understand that we're all connected and that we need to support each other, and it's a lot of fun. Well, I love speaking, and I love my audiences, and it's what a great job because I feel like I'm being able to take all the things that I read about and learn and also the experiences I have, and I feel like I'm actually helping people, showing them another way, you know? So for me, I just keep growing and learning, and I take the talks that I already have and I add to them. So it's fun because I do love change, and it gives me an opportunity to keep changing and growing and moving. So I'm taking, like, for example, the Generations Project, which I started out in the beginning, just speaking on the different generations, and now we're talking about how do we attract the generations, how do we sell to the generations, working with the generations in healthcare. So it's given me an opportunity to really specialize and take what I've already worked with and really grow that idea even more. I love it, and I'm very lucky, and I'm very blessed for what I do. And hey, thanks for this interview.